Welcome to the WP Builds Podcast, bringing you the latest news from the WordPress community. Now, welcome your hosts, David Wormsley and Nathan Wrigley.
Hello there and welcome to the WP Builds Podcast. You have reached episode number 329. It's the ninth episode in our Thinking the Unthinkable series, and it's entitled WordPress is Too Expensive. It was published on Thursday the 1st of June 2023. My name's Nathan Wrigley, and a few bits of housekeeping before we join David Wormsley. The first thing to say is we won't be having a podcast episode next week. I'm taking a trip to Athens to attend WordCamp EU. If you're there, I really hope that our paths cross. If you're not there, normal service will resume the week after next, so sorry about that. For those that are curious about what we're doing over at WP Builds, I've added a new section to the homepage. If you go to wpbuilds.com and scroll down a little bit, there's a black section entitled Coming Up, and at the moment it's showing three cards listing three events. The first one is happening on the 1st of June, so it's the day this podcast is released, so if you're lucky you might be able to catch us live. It's me chatting with Anne McCarthy from Automatic all about what's coming up in WordPress, in this case WordPress 6.3. Also, on the 13th of June, I'll be having our UI UX show with Pete Chenery, and then also picking up the WS Form webinar series. We're on episode 5. That's going to be happening on the 21st of June. So those little cards will give you the calendar dates, but they'll also give you calendar links so that you can book those events into your calendar. So remember, that's on the wpbuilds.com homepage. The WP Builds podcast is brought to you today by GoDaddy Pro. GoDaddy Pro, the home of managed WordPress hosting that includes free domain, SSL, and 24/7 support. Bundle that with the Hub by GoDaddy Pro to unlock more free benefits to manage multiple sites in one place, invoice clients, and get 30% off new purchases. You can find out more by heading to go.me/WPBuilds. Once more, go.me/WPBuilds. And we do thank GoDaddy Pro for their ongoing, continuing support of the WP Builds podcast. Okay, what have we got for you today? As I said at the top of the show, this is the ninth episode in our Thinking the Unthinkable series, and today we're discussing the subject, WordPress is too expensive. What's your opinion on this? We probably can find ways of building sites completely for free. We are, of course, able to download the software utterly free, but do expenses creep up? We've got plugins, we've got themes, we've got hosting, we've got firewalls and security, all of that stuff. Is it possible to do things on the cheap, and how might we do that? I do hope that you enjoy this episode.
Hello, this is the ninth episode of our Thinking the Unthinkable series, and today's unpalatable thought is WordPress is too expensive. Nathan, surely we can dismiss this one straight away as insane ramblings, right? It's entirely free.
It's so not entirely free, though, is it? We both know it's not entirely free. Yeah, okay, so there's obviously complications to this. Of course, the software itself is free, but during the course of this episode we're going to try and talk about all of the ways where the costs really can pile up, and whilst if you've been using WordPress for any length of time, you'll probably know what those costs are, but there certainly can be a lot of them. So yes, it's free, and actually, do you know what, especially with full site editing, now just called site editing, I do feel that if you really do want a bare bones website but you want a little bit of customization options, then you really could do it for free, but you really are going to be limited in the scope, and probably what you're capable of doing will be limited, shall we say.
And I'm one of the people that love or loathe Gutenberg, and I tend to be on the loathe it side of things, where you're in the love it. But, you know, I have to concede here that, you know, if you're looking for something that's not expensive, this Gutenberg, even if it's not where it should be right now for everybody, it is seeing a lot of good investment, meaning that it is a proper competitor to the alternatives most people who want to DIY it anyway would have, which is Wix and Squarespace and those kind of things. So, you know, from that angle, you know, it is, you know, from a DIY's perspective, certainly it seems a competitively cheap option.
Yeah, I wonder what it would have been like if we didn't get Gutenberg, if we were still using what's now called the classic editor. I wonder what the landscape for WordPress would look like at this point.
Yeah. You know,
whether a lot of us would be clamoring for some kind of page builder functionality built in with the ability to edit headers and footers and all of that kind of stuff. Yeah, it's interesting. But I think it had to go that way just because, really, the WordPress.com, I guess, which in some way props up WordPress.org, there was direct competition between things like Wix and Squarespace. And so this editor had to be built. Now, whether or not the editor that we've got in WordPress is as good as the editors in third-party SaaS apps, I guess it's debatable. I've certainly experienced glitches and problems with Gutenberg, and I've also experienced incredible UIs in all sorts of other rival products. Some of them have got nothing to do with building websites. You know, they're just SaaS products like CRMs or something like that. But I think it had to happen.
Yeah, well, I've always struggled with this. Obviously, I'm coming from the point of view of somebody who's used it long term. And when I came in, it was the free way for me to be able to get into the dynamic web, to be able to do things like I couldn't have possibly done it before, like get into e-commerce and membership sites, wasn't available. And largely I came in that without paying a penny. But over the time I've seen that, you know, I've slowly adopted more of the premium options that go with WordPress, which has seen its growth over the years. So I kind of started free. And I've actually ended up using Gutenberg free in the end. But in the middle, it's cost me quite a bit because I've jumped on board with a lot of premium add-ons.
When you began using WordPress, do you remember how the messaging was on WordPress.org? So did it talk about free and all of that? Because now, at this moment, if you go to WordPress.org, the big message, the big H1 message is WordPress, grow your business. That's an interesting flavor, isn't it? And then it, underneath that, the text is create a place for your business, your interests, or anything else with the open source platform that powers the web. So it doesn't really get into free. It just says open source. And so I guess most people know that that means free, but it doesn't specifically go out of its way to say it won't cost you a penny, which is interesting.
Yeah, and I think when I came in, it felt like you found this little secret club on the web that were finding a cheat way to get into all this clever stuff. So WordPress, you know, was still mostly seen as this blogging platform, but a little bit more simpler for people like me than something like Drupal. And there were all these like wonderful people doing these free plugins to extend this blogging platform then. So there were people like Justin Tadlock who got me in with his first kind of attempt at a membership plugin. And all these things were free. It was their experiment. So it felt like you kind of got into this small club of people, these developers who knew a bit more than you, and you could jump on it. So that's how it felt like. It didn't feel like some big organization. It felt like this real true sort of grassroots open source project when I came in, and I was just finding wonderful ways. And I think that's how it was in the early days. I think people, you know, it wasn't the obvious choice. But I guess people were coming in because in some ways it was the obvious choice to a lot of people. It was, you know, with all of these themes which were ready made and good to go for bloggers, that was pulling actual people in as well, you know. So
yeah, it's really, really interesting that the WordPress.org doesn't really talk up the free. So we got that message, grow your business, and then beneath that, dream it, build it. And then it talks about how you can see what your site will look like with blocks and so on. And then underneath that, powerful and empowering, you style it your way, plug in and extend. There's a bit of a nod, I suppose, to the 50,000, 55,000, it says at the moment, plugins. But again, it doesn't say free. It says make WordPress do whatever you need it to. Add a store, mailing list, portfolio, social feed, analytics. You're in control with over 55,000 plugins. I'm just seeing if there's any mention of free anywhere. Build for yourself, not by yourself. Community at its core. There's lots here, but I seem to remember that that was a big thing back in the day when I was, you know, using Drupal and Magento and things.
Yeah.
That the free thing was a big part of the pitch. Now it's definitely much more professional looking, shall we say, and it looks like that's mentioned less and less. And I wonder if that's because somehow we all know that it's It is, in theory, free, but in practice, there's costs attached.
Yeah. Do you, I mean, another explanation for that may be because there's a starting assumption that it is the free open source option, so they don't need to plug, you know, don't need to say it so much.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
I mean, essentially, it never was in because of the fact the way that it's built, it needs a server, and that means that you have to buy hosting if you're going to do it yourself and pay for that server, aren't you?
Yeah, and actually we should probably launch why it's not free right at this point. And that's the first thing, right, is that you've got to obviously put it somewhere. In the past, you've always had to go to some hosting provider, so whichever company that is. And it was interesting, we did quite a bit of poking around on the internet before we hit record, and it really is fascinating how much or little you can pay for that hosting. You know, I guess you and I have both been around the house so many times that we've got a real good idea of where the price point is that we're happy with. But if you're coming into this space, you know, you can pay hundreds of dollars a month or almost nothing a month.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I do think there's an element where, you know, WordPress obviously has gained its popularity because it does, like all open source projects, you know, you think, there's a good way of getting stuff cheaper than I need to do. And it's definitely been a trap for me. You know, I've considered myself, even though I started with code a bit, still I was a fairly naive DIYer when I started with WordPress. So it was a cheap start for me to get on with it, but over the long term, not only are there the plugins which you are just constantly tempted to keep buying into, which keep increasing their prices, they see their value is worth more, but the hosting and maintenance is something I didn't really understand with it, because you know, you've got this big, all these plugins that you can try out, but what you don't realize is somebody new who doesn't understand hosting, everyone you add increases the amount of server resources it requires, so you end up upping your costs in terms of hosting.
When you started using WordPress and chucking in plugins, did you even really have an idea that you were going to have to pay for these, well, ostensibly ad infinitum, let's say for several years, because you installed something, it went onto a client site, that client then obviously needs that plugin on their website from now on, and although you probably won't be making use of any new features, it's now a part of their website, so that license has to be renewed. Because I definitely fell into that trap. Not only did I buy plugins at different times of the year, so nothing ever renewed at the same time. So, you know, you'd have a couple of things renewing in January, you'd have a bit of time off, and then one or two in March, and several in June or whatever. There was no pattern to it. So I slowly started to ramp up and ramp up and ramp up. And then I was sort of shocked one day when I made a spreadsheet of everything that I was using. This is so terrible to admit, but I genuinely had no idea what I was spending, and it was way more than I thought it was. And that was just plugin license renewals, and most of them were just on client websites, and I really wasn't even sure if they were making any use of them.
Yeah, we know this. And I mean, that's, we've all seen the surge as well too. Well, yeah, this is getting a bit much. Let's look out for lifetime deals.
And
I think when you came into WordPress, you were already prepared to buy. Yeah, I think you had already decided, as you'd done Drupal for free, basically not paying for stuff.
That's right,
You came into WordPress already with the view to get the premium stuff. That was perhaps the professional way. You had somebody to support it, pay for that. In my thing, because I went with WordPress a bit longer, I was all free. But in that time, it seemed okay, because WordPress didn't change that much. I mean, at best, and I think it would even skip years, it only had a fairly trivial update once a year. And most of the plugins, again, were developer-led, did one thing. So basically, when I was building those sites, I didn't really feel there was a maintenance job. I didn't need somebody to support it. It was kept fairly simple. As time went on, suddenly I realized, well, actually, I need to jump on with people who professionally support these plugins, and I expect them to do more for me as well. So yeah, same as you. You know, suddenly you get to the point where you go, wow, I am paying a lot.
Yeah, I remember the spreadsheet. You know, I had to scroll several times to get to the bottom of it. There were dozens and dozens of plugins in there, and some of them, not cheap, and some of them just really overlapping. I'll tell you one thing that's curious, that because I joined WordPress after that whole premium plugin debate had gone away, you know, nobody was arguing that premium was okay. Because that was all in place when I arrived, it was okay for me to spend all that money, and I didn't really think about it twice. And so I ended up frequenting the pages of the pro license, if you know what I mean. I never really spent a lot of time digging around in WordPress.org, the plugin repo, trying to find answers to everything. Typically, I would go to Google and Google things, and usually, you know, the website of the pro version is optimized better. So let's say, for example, I wanted a form plugin or something. The WordPress.org repo form plugins pages are not going to rise to the top. The ones that you're going to pay for are. And so I think that also helped drag me into spending money.
Yeah, but I think, you know, you and I kind of got to know each other about the same time of really investing in those plugins. We kind of saw that was the professional thing. We're building sites for clients. We need professional backup. We're going to buy out. And that was quite a change for me. That was a sort of awakening of becoming professional. You know, I'm going to buy. But of course, you know, over the time, I flipped the other way, where I'm just thinking, wow, this is a whole bunch of dependencies, not only an expense.
Yeah, I kind of flipped in that at some point I realized that I was just running my business badly. And me having to charge clients for these licenses not only was a complete time suck, but I also, you know, I really wasn't wanting to put a premium on top. So if a plugin cost $100 a year, I wasn't trying to wrap that up in, I don't know, charging $200 and an administration fee, if you like. I got to the point where I ended up saying, look, this is the website I'm going to build for you, and it's going to require this, 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 and this. Will you go out and get them and then just give me the license codes? And then it's up to you to renew them in the future. That, in the end, got rid of that headache for me. And the clients never griped about the fact that, what do you mean we've got to spend money on plugins? They just saw that as a business expense. You know, they could write it off for tax, plus it enabled them to get functionality that I couldn't have built, and certainly couldn't have built anywhere near the cost of $99 a year. So that's the way I sidestepped that. I made my business offset that cost to the clients.
But didn't we also, at the same time, I mean, it's also at the time of really investing in premium plugins at, you know, quite a high cost, was also at the same time where we was also saying, well, actually, there's another income through the hosting and site care.
Yep.
You know, and you would build this in. So it was like, you know, everything you bought that was a premium plugin was an extra option to you join our club, you know, on your site care. And you've got access to all these things that if you left us would cost you this amount.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. And I never really went down that route that way, because I just know how woeful I am at keeping a track of things. So as an example, to this day, I still get things that renew, and I've no idea that it's coming. And I should know, because it's the same day every year. I probably could have gone in and clicked on a button somewhere to say, notify me before that, you know, before the payment's going to go through, but I didn't. And it still happens to me. And because of that real inability for me to manage when things were happening and when the billing cycle should occur, I just decided it was easier for me, because I wasn't trying to make any money out of that anyway, just to give the licenses to the clients and, well, you know, get them to get their own license.
Yeah. The difficulty for me with WordPress is that over the time, the value, because of how popular it's become over time, and everybody who's a vested interest in plugin makers, and also, you know, there's been more specialized WordPress hosting available. You know, there's a lot of people who have been upping the value of what their product is worth or what they think it's worth now. So we've seen, you know, as we mentioned before, the you can really pay a lot for your hosting. And in some ways, you know, I've needed to up what I expected to pay in hosting, because simply I would cram more of the plugins and use up more resources. So I needed better hosting. But yeah, it does feel like over the time, it's like, wow, for me, some of this is kind of the cost of some of plugins and hosting has gone way beyond what I think is worth the value to clients.
Yeah, I guess it's interesting, isn't it? Because you're deeply embedded in the ecosystem and you really understand what's required, you can probably sidestep a lot of that. So as an example, I'm sure you would be able to get really a good server for a very inexpensive cost because you know what you're doing. Yeah. But it's not a case of just clicking a couple of buttons and up. Look, you're ready. You're off to the races. You know, you'll have to support that. You'll have to figure out how to recover if there's a disaster. But you'll be able to do it and you'll be able to save yourself a lot of money. Whereas I think people coming into this space, DIYers, you've described it in our show notes as, is there a trap for DIYers because they, you know, they're coming in. It's a bit like, a good analogy would be me going into like a secondhand car salesman showroom. I haven't the faintest idea what I'm doing. The guy in there could rip me off blind and probably has several times. And I really wouldn't know. I would just assume, okay, right, okay, it's got that. I need that, right? Do I need those? Yes, probably. I'll take those as well. It's a bit like that. If you come into this space, there are so many competing products. The prices seem to be going up and up and up. And you're constantly being told that your website needs this thing and that thing for Google, for SEO, for optimization, whatever else it is. Yeah, it all starts to ramp up. But you can avoid that a bit because you know what you're doing and you're in the weeds every day.
Yeah. Did we mention it? We had a chat, I remember, last week where I mentioned this. I don't know if we said it in the podcast, but a revelation to me suddenly became about the fact that WordPress does still rely on a LAMP stack. So you need that server, and that server has a cost. And WordPress.com effectively is in the hosting business for servers. And so are many of the people who are buying out the plugins now, those traditional hosting companies are there. Now, how I've been able to cheat the system first with hosting is when the cloud option was there to manage your own cloud hosting. That allowed me to less depend on hosting companies to do all of that for me and go independent and do it more cheaply. And then more significantly for all of these people now is the serverless option, which is becoming an option both within WordPress because you can go headless, but you know, externally. So I do think, you know, there's an element of both WordPress.com and a lot of the hosting companies need to be able to bring people in with easy ways, cheap ways to build their sites in order to effectively lock them into their server-based hosting.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? Because I think it's fair to say that over time, the things that you might need for your WordPress website have increased. You know, maybe a decade ago, you may have installed one, maybe a couple of things. And now I think quite a lot of people would require their website to be more functional. You know, it might have a booking system in there or e-commerce or an LMS or whatever it might be. So you end up with more and more things in there. I feel like the prices have slowly been going north. Maybe that's just inflation, but maybe not. But so that then creates a space for people to come in and figure out cheaper ways of doing it. And it feels like it feels like some hosting companies have really got into that. So, you know, you can think, I'm sure that you could mention a whole bunch of different companies who offer really cheap, flattened website hosting for pennies, really, a year. And they've just sort of seen that, haven't they? They've seen that, okay, people are grumbling about the cost of hosting. They're not entirely sure that the cost-benefit balance is in their favor. Why don't we come up with a solution for that? And they're filling that market. It feels like it's still a tiny slice of that pie, but maybe in the future, well, certainly you're hoping, I think, that that will become a bigger part of the pie and make it cheaper to host sites.
Yeah. I mean, can you imagine? I mean, it'll be a long way in the future, and I don't know if WordPress will ever steer that way, but, you know, can you imagine if Gutenberg becomes a very good user interface and they find ways that you can, as they're looking into at the moment, where you can start to operate that using the JavaScript technology without having to depend on the LAMP stack to build your sites, and then that can be turned into static output, you know, led by WordPress.com even, you know, so it changes its business format. I mean, then if it did all of that stuff, it would be moving to where we are going, I think, and it would just be the ultimate leader. But how on earth it would ever become from what it's been is this, you know, 20 years old it almost is now, isn't it, WordPress?
Yeah.
So, you know, and it was built on another technology, that LAMP stack, and it's, you know, how will it bring everybody together to that? But, you know, I don't... So as I move a little bit to less dependency on WordPress, I always keep in the fact that you never know how it's going to surprise us in the future. And what direction it might go.
You mentioned that WordPress.com, in your opinion, was like basically like a hosting company in a way.
Yeah, so it's a server-based hosting company for people who need a lamp stack, you know,
really. If they pushed all of those free JavaScript in the browser based possibilities, you do wonder if that would be shooting themselves in the foot, and what the impact would be on WordPress.org because of this sort of trickle down way that the project works.
Yeah, but you know what? I mean, I imagine in the same way that someone has been put into a kind of serverless building of Gutenberg, that I'll be surprised if WordPress.com aren't at least investing some money in looking how they can be the next Versailles or Netlify or whatever in their hosting approach, you know? Just what I mean. I don't think it'll ever stop there, but I mean, to move to that at the moment, in a way, that Jamstack movement is a threat to WordPress because of its old stack, if you like. But, you know, with the headless, some people are going that way, and there's no reason why effectively WordPress couldn't go that route itself, you know?
So we've talked about hosting being a considerable cost. I mean, at the minute, you really don't have too many choices. You are going to have to pay something for hosting. Whether that's a tiny amount or you want to spend a giant amount is really up to you, but you can't escape that. Plugins, it feels like really most websites are going to have several plugins in there. Sure enough, you can probably get them for free. Depends on the functionality you want, but that's going to be another expense. So hosting, plugins, add all that in. The money's starting to tot up on an annual basis. It's probably still not that alarming each month, but when you add up the cost every year, it suddenly starts to be a bit daunting. What else might we be paying for apart from plugins and hosting?
Well, you can be paying for these things going wrong. I mean, at the moment, I'm looking over a potential client site who, you know, their software is now abandoned now because there are other ways to do it. So a rebuild is their only approach. So that is always a possibility. Or, you know, if you're not too careful with what you pick for your software and you don't do your updates, of course, you know, it can get very costly in terms of fixing a security issue, a hack.
Oh, I see. Yeah, that's an interesting point. Luckily, I've been largely immune from that. WordPress has been, and the plugins that I've chosen have insulated me, so I feel really lucky to have gotten away from that. But there's also this idea, hopefully a money-saving idea, of canonical plugins. This hasn't really happened yet, but I kind of really like this. And this is the idea of shipping some things which are more or less suitable to be put into WordPress core, but not quite. And I don't really know what the pantheon of canonical plugins would look like, but you've got to think it would be things like speed optimization, possibly some SEO basics, I don't really know, but those kind of things. And the idea is that you would be able to get those for free from WordPress.org, but also they would come with a guarantee that they would be maintained, kept secure, constantly updated. And in many ways, they are basically core, but an option to add into core. I don't know if you think that's going to be something of interest and certainly a way of saving a bit of money.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it's logical that WordPress should go that way. In some ways, it's a terrible threat to some of the plugin authors that we've supported over our time.
It really is,
But, you know, logically, I mean, it's the obvious way, because the one downside that WordPress has is that it can't, like Wix and Squarespace, change to reflect technology moving. It has to, you know, do it slowly because of the fact that there's lots of different plugin authors there and they can't break stuff. So with Canonical, if you say there's a set of tools that are going to work with the new Gutenberg project and they're all going to work together, well, they can all change together, and somebody coming in new who knows this, how they communicate this is another thing. But if they know this, then it's kind of going to be your safer option, isn't it? And your cheaper option.
Yeah. If there's let's take SEO as an example. Let's imagine that ended up as some sort of canonical plugin. If you can get a decent free version which you know is going to be updated. It's not reliant on a particular individual who might, excuse the reference, you know, get fall under a boss. This is being maintained by responsible people who will go through security audits. It seems like a bit of a no-brainer to use those bits and pieces. I guess we'll just have to see how that whole idea of Canonical plugins goes and what the scope of that is.
The scary part about that does allow an extra level of control, if you like, by one person, really, Matt, you know, over how, you know, the direction of WordPress, you know. Once you've got that in place, it very much, but you know, you can see the logic of it.
Yeah, that's a really good point, because if something gets the badge of Canonical,
yeah,
presumably it would sit inside a different area of the WordPress repo. You know, yeah, you could filter down to Canonical plugins. It's almost like an endorsement, isn't it? Whereas at the moment, there's a whole heap of plugins that are managed by automatic, let's say, and you have to go and discover those. They don't sort of surface themselves by default. Whereas these ones, they really would, and that might be, well, something that commercial plugins worry about, because obviously discoverability is a really, really big thing.
Yeah, and you know, there's going to be a lot of politics in this, and it's always been a tricky thing. God knows how it really works, but there's this competition and cooperation all the time, pulling in different ways, isn't there? So you imagine, you know, you get a Canonical SEO plugin, but the big player, the number one, has been Yoast SEO all of that time. And now, you know, if there was something that was seriously threatening that, it threatens Yoast. But Yoast also have been one of the biggest people for contributing to the WordPress project itself. So there's a real kind of difficult thing to balance here, isn't there?
Yeah, I feel there'll have to be some very clever moves around what is a Canonical plugin and who gets to put into it. And be interesting how that goes. Just a total aside, nothing to do with the cost of anything. I saw a piece this week which we talked about prior to clicking record, and I just thought it was an interesting idea around Canonical.
Yeah,
and it was a piece that I'll link to in the show notes, where somebody on the WP Marmite website, I'm not entirely sure who wrote it, but if you click on the link in the show notes, they've created a post called "What If WordPress Moved On From Blogging?" And this was the idea of stripping out the post functionality in WordPress so that all you had was pages, and whether or not that might be a sensible default for WordPress going forwards. And I really like the idea of this and making the blog functionality, so posts and categories and archives and all of that, making that a feature which you have to download, i.e. a Canonical plugin around posts. So totally off-piste, but just curious as to what you think.
Yeah, heretic, burn them.
Yeah.
It's a blogging platform. What the heck? No, it does make sense in the modern day. I mean, particularly, you know, who is being attracted to WordPress has changed, doesn't it? It's not the blogging platform. And a lot of people are, you know, the threat is Wix and Squarespace, who fundamentally their customers are not going for a blog, they're going for pages. So, yeah, kind of makes sense. But gosh, I can't imagine how that one will play out in the wider community.
My guess is it won't play out. But I just thought it was a curious idea, in that if I was building a brochure site, I would definitely like it to be that way, you know, because I really do. It always never ceased to amaze me how confusing it was for people who were my clients, differentiating what is a page and what is a post. It seemingly didn't matter how many times I explained it. It was very hard for them to see, yeah, but it looks the same. Okay, well, it's not the same. A post is, you know, it's got an archive with it, and you can create them over time, and they'll go in some kind of order, and you can search for them and all. Yeah, but that's a page. It looks like a page. Yes, it does look like a page, doesn't it? And so I felt that in many ways, if it was a brochure site, having it that way, configured that way around, would be really great.
Yeah, and exactly. I mean, our route into WordPress is through that you know, largely certain yeah. people with static pages, process sites, that kind of thing. Was that route in? So yeah. it's, I mean, I don't know. It's just, again, you know, with WordPress, we were saying about this, it's always difficult to kind of know your audience, you know, with it, because there are so many different ways into WordPress, I think, and opinions on it. So it's kind of what you make it, isn't it? So yeah. for us, that makes a lot of sense, given our background and difficulty of understanding posts to people who probably wouldn't use posts.
Yeah. And you're sorry for that, a complete aside. Yeah. But yeah. just getting, no, back no, to right. the, getting back to the cost of the website argument, or whether it's free, I know that you at the minute are really trying to strip down the dependencies that you've got, not only in terms of free plugins, but also the ones that you pay for. How's that endeavor going? Are you managing to strip out a lot of the things which you once thought were essential?
Yeah, well, there's a lot that's changed for me. For one thing is that I feel like I've grown up a little bit now. So I try and lead the clients to do a bit of design thinking, if you like, really empathize with the user and know what it is that they need to complete their tasks. And most of the time, that has meant stripping away a lot of rubbish that I used to think I needed for my website builds, a lot of galleries and drop-down menus and all sorts of clever stuff. Doesn't need to be there because it doesn't serve the purpose. So a lot of that, if you like, was before I moved to where I am now, I did a lot of simplifying, saying, do I really need this? Can I build this myself? Can I simplify? So that's my direction. And so I reduced my dependency. Ultimately, where I've gone now is I'm still using WordPress daily and freely, back to where I began, but I'm using it now to create static sites locally and made it free. So yeah, I mean, I've really stripped back again. So WordPress for me is free again.
Yeah, I was going to say, so maybe don't, without mentioning yeah. names if you don't want to, yeah. about are there any things which you still depend on apart from WordPress? Is there one kind of can't let go of that plugin that you're gonna be using till the end of time?
You know, I don't think, well, I will mention the name because I'm happy to promote them, which is, for me, it's been very convenient to be able to use WP Codebox because it's like bringing a coding system within to WordPress. So I can do a lot more manual stuff. So for me, but it's not absolutely essential. I know how I'd go if that disappeared. So no, there isn't any, I've tried to avoid all the dependencies, but still, you know, it's that basic way of organizing my content, which is more back to the code. WordPress is still, you know, king for me for that, because it makes it so much easier to work with it with some really simple plugins.
So if WP Codebox is now the only thing which you are more or less guaranteed to put...
Oh, there is one other thing.
Oh, go on, yeah.
Yeah, which we've talked about before, which is simply static, to turn the sites into static. But again, there are other ways of doing that. But yeah, those two together are probably my most, you know, depended on.
But that's a free version, right?
Yep, free yep. version.
So you've got a dependency there, but in terms of this podcast, it's not actually costing you anything. And WP Codebox, I think, is no longer costing you anything, right? You've managed
exactly.
to get
it's
in
paid
on a,
once.
Some sort of lifetime deal, right?
Yeah, exactly. So I paid for that once, and that's good. But you know what? The thing is, and I'm stealing from somebody else on their YouTube channel, what got me going on this kind of... a way of simplifying things, if you like, was somebody who, with different tools, I can't remember what they're using, but this shows how a novice can use WordPress for free and get the hosting for free. What they showed was you just download something like local WP. So you've got it on your local computer, free, fairly easy to use if you're not technical. You load in WordPress, which it can do very easily for you. You go over to something like Astra Sites. You load in something, perhaps using the Gutenberg blocks, get a design, fill it in with your content, put in something like Simply Static to turn it into a zip file, and then upload it to a program like Netlify, and your free allowance will probably give you a free site.
So everything there is free, right? I mean, you...
Yeah.
So WordPress free, the Netlify allowance for the hosting free, you're using Simply Static to flatten the site, and that's, you can do that in the free version. So you've got some dependencies there. So you're not free of dependencies, but in terms of money, that those sites are free. I guess the only downside there is that it's on your local machine because you've cut out the sort of hosting side of it. But it does mean that there is no cost there. How do you work with your clients on that then? Do they just send you details and you work with them and it's on your screen? How do you modify things?
All right. Well, yeah, I mean, this is the whole thing about getting people off the idea that they rely on a CMS. I mean, really, over the years, what I've decided is that most people, they want to, I mean, if you say, we talked about this before, if you say to a client, do you want a way to be able to change your own content on your website or not? Do you want to do it through me? They're always going to say, yeah, I'll have the, but the downside is this huge dependency and cost in the type of hosting that you have. So I think now I will largely lead people to say, do you actually need a CMS? Because it does have some costs that go with it. Or would you rather put it through me? Here's the benefit of putting it through me, is that I think about this stuff all the time. So when I'm putting your content in, I'm going to be thinking about the latest device, what resolutions are going to be there. I'm going to be thinking about performance, what Google are looking for in terms of its metadata. Do you want to just shove it to me instead and I'll do it for you? So I'm leading people away from the content management system. But you know, I mentioned this quick, easy way for novices, if you like to start. I put an extra step in, which is to go via, you know, hand code it and then go via GitHub to put it out into a static version. So I've made it a little bit more complex.
That's just to automate the process so you don't have to
It's also a backup process as well for me, so you can go back to earlier, and also a way of being allowed to, you know, bring in developers who might need to build you something custom into the project. Everybody knows how to use GitHub and they can fork it and add in stuff.
Yeah.
You know, so
we should probably draw attention to the fact that your version of flattening websites stands in contrast to headless, which is a different approach.
Exactly.
And I suspect that headless is not a particularly cheap way of going about things, although it is mightily clever and capable of doing all sorts of amazing things, connecting WordPress on the back end to something different on the front end, but they're not really the same thing.
No. And you know, I mean, it's all of that. I mean, I never got the headless. We've had conversations about this before.
Hard.
You talked about it. And honestly, I just didn't get it. I was like, well, why would you want to pay all that money for all that complexity when you can put cash in on, when I was very much in the CMS, but now I appreciate it, but I've gone a cheapskate way of sort of bypassing that because it is complex. But if you need a CMS, if your client is the type who actually does need to put their content in, and of course, you know, if you're publishing with a, you know, a large company and they actually do individually need to go in that, they don't, kind of reliance on me is pointless. They're going to need something like headless, aren't they, if they want to go the static route.
Yeah, if they want to go the static route or just a regular WordPress website, if they just want to keep it, you know, traditional and simple. Okay, so we talked about the monetary cost. Do you want to quickly, because we're on 40 minutes already, blimey neck, do you want to talk about the sort of freedoms in the more philosophical sense?
No.
You don't? No, okay.
No. No, we can. Yeah, we should mention that because one of the biggest confusions always is with the word free with WordPress, which is maybe why they're not mentioning it, because you know, much is made of the freedoms that come with the GPL. I think these days, which is, should we just
read them out, because they're cool, actually.
They are. The freedom to run the program for any purpose, the freedom to study how the program works and change it so it does the computing as the user wishes, the freedom to redistribute copies so that users can help each other, the freedom to distribute copies of modified versions of others. And
I do wonder how many people even get what that means, but also care about what that means. So, as an example, I don't suppose an end user really is all that bothered about the freedoms. If you go to them and a client, I mean, if you go to them and say, well, there's this free piece of software, I think the instinct there has often been, what do you mean it's free? How can it be free? That's not right. There's something a bit fishy here. And then you go on to explain this and say, actually, it's pretty unique the way this works, but this is how it works. It's hard to explain, but they get it in the end, and I think they like it. But I do think that we are the only people that care too much about that. It's people like you and I who are obsessing about WordPress all the time. I don't think most end users really have much to say about this.
I'd be really interested. We taught this about this before with GPL, and the fact that because of this kind of freedom, it does mean that you've got these GPL clubs that can just take their copy and distribute it to other people. So, you know, for a few dollars, you can go and buy any of the really expensive plugins and put them in, assuming you can trust the GPL club that you're getting them from. And I just wonder, because it seems to have gone more, well, again, this might be something to do with my YouTube viewing, but I get a lot of adverts by companies that look quite creditable now or spending a good deal of money on YouTube advertising to say, you know, don't spend so much money on your WordPress plugins. Come to us.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
oh, you see, yeah, I barely watch anything on YouTube, and certainly my YouTube consumption isn't polluted by that. But what? So you're saying that these GPL clubs, which are basically using the freedoms that you get to take copies of commercial plugins and then redistribute them for money, there's nothing illegal about it. There's something sort of, I guess, morally questionable about it. But they're getting all slick and clever, are they? They look like big businesses now. That's fascinating.
Yeah, they've got proper present. You know, usually you would, it's kind of one of these hidden things, you know, where it always feels a bit dodgy, you know. But no, they're facing it out. They're employing proper presenters to come on and explain how you don't need to spend so much, you know. They've actually got a face. Obviously, it's somebody they've employed to do that job. But yeah,
it does
kind of looks creditable.
It really does feel a bit like biting the hand that feeds, doesn't it? If they're incredibly successful, then ultimately they're eating their own lunch, and you know, at some point they're going to starve. Yeah. That's really interesting. I don't hang out in those places, the GPL clubs. I don't even know how they work or how you might sign up for them, but that's fascinating. I mean, but that is more free stuff though, isn't it? You are suddenly into the realms of even things which you may have had to pay for.
Yeah,
that's free. And in your scenario where you're taking the website offline, so long as you can be fairly sure that the version that you've got is clean at the time that you install it, you don't need to be updating it, because your website's never live.
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, I used to run a little Beaver Builder Beginners Facebook group, and actually I was quite surprised to see how many people had appeared. It's a very small group, how many people had appeared who clearly must have bought Beaver Builder through a GPL club, you know? And they didn't see the distinction, you know? They thought they bought Beaver Builder, you know, they bought it from a GPL club and they were coming in for advice. So clearly it is grabbing a lot of people.
Wow. Wow. Mm. That's really interesting. Yeah, definitely a shadier side of the whole thing. Actually, do you know what? That would be a good episode for just dedicated to that. One of these thinking the unthinkable things, something along the lines of, GPL clubs are great, aren't they? Or something, you know.
Is sleazy. GPL is sleazy.
Yeah. I think at 45 minutes, we should probably knock it on the head. I think, how does it boil down? Is WordPress free? Maybe. Can it be free? David proves it can. Is it typical for it to be free? Probably not. You're going to be paying left, right, and center for all sorts of things.
Yeah, I think that's the case. I mean, it's as expensive, I guess, as you decide to make it, really.
That's the perfect place to end it. Let's go no further. Pearls of wisdom dripping out of David's mouth. Let's end it there.
Okay, no. See you next time.
Well, I hope that you enjoyed that. Always lovely to chat with David about these things. What do you think, though? Is WordPress too expensive? Have you noticed the cost of using WordPress creeping up over the years? Perhaps you're still managing to do it cheaply. Give us your thoughts. Head over to the wpbuilds.com website and search for episode number 329 and leave us a comment there. The WP Builds podcast was brought to you today by GoDaddy Pro. GoDaddy Pro, the home of managed WordPress hosting that includes free domain, SSL, and 24/7 support. Bundle that with the Hub by GoDaddy Pro to unlock more free benefits to manage multiple sites in one place, invoice clients, and get 30% off new purchases. Find out more. Head to go.me/WPBuilds. And we really do thank GoDaddy Pro for their support of the WP Builds podcast. Well, we won't be back next week. As I said at the top of the show, I'm having a week off. We're going to go to WordCamp Europe. Hopefully, I will see you there. If you do see me, come and say hi. I'd really appreciate that. But normal service will resume the week after that. So we'll see you there. Have a good week. Stay safe. Bye-bye for now.